Okay, so for this example, I will create some artificial data, and the data is, in this example, one second here, I need to have the chat screen. On here. And the data I chose is just a series of like coin tosses, which I label here heads and tails. Here's the chat. Okay, there's a question on how to open FITS files. And this is, I will talk about this after we do here the visualization. Okay. So I label the data heads and tails, and I just toss my coin 1,000 times. So the first thing you should always do when you have data, you should actually look at the data. So in this example, this is just a list of T's and H's. The length is 1,000. This is how the data looks like. So it's one dimension. It's basically it's binary, yes or no. And one way to visualize this data could be a histogram. A histogram for this kind of data is, as we see, not too helpful, because the underlying probability was 50-50, and we can confirm this by looking at the histogram. If we do the histogram, we just count how many tails, how many heads, 506, and how many tails we had, 494. What we lose is, for example, the information of the order in which the data came in. In a sense, you could say the order is an additional dimension of your data. One way to visualize the order is, for example, I modify my data and replace every head with a minus one and a tail with a plus one, and then just do and then plot the data as points. So every point here that's a one is a tail, and heads is on the lower side of the figure. And in this visualization, I also connect every single data point here with the x-axis. And what we see is that some patterns appear. For example, we note that there is stretches of like repeatedly drawing heads and no tails and so on. So we could actually see if there is some irregularity in which the data comes in, if some additional pattern shows up. For example, if we look at the first 30 data items, we see that the first six was six tails in a row. And we have here another row of seven tails. So one additional visualization could be, let's count the occurrence of repeated tails and head patterns. How many times do we have two heads in a row? How many times do we have five tails in a row? And so on and so on. So I have to count repeated patterns of heads and tails. And I do this here with these two commands. in Mathematica. In Python, you would have to come up with a different way to do this. And if I look at the tail sequence, this is 6 for the first 6 tails, 1 for one single tail, 5 for the next 5 tails, again 1 for this one, 2 for the 2, and so on. And then I can, for example, do a histogram on these two. And this is here the paired histogram for the heads on the right-hand side. So we have 116 times in single tails, heads, 71 times paired heads, and so on and so on. So you could come up with different ideas. This is just an example. You could look at frequency distributions for certain patterns. I don't know. Okay. The two-dimensional data is maybe the most common one that you already know from many of the experiments that you did in the practicas. And one data that we use here is, for example, just download the world population data from this website here. When we look at the data, we note that it's a two-dimensional thing. So we always have an x value and a y value. X here is a year, it's a time. And this is the number of people living on the Earth at that time. The first year is from minus 10,000 BC, and the last data point here is from 2015, 7.35 billion people. Yeah. Again, we look at the data. This is how it looks like. And what we can do is we can just plot the data. So for every x point, we draw a point at the corresponding y value. And now my software crashes. Okay. Yeah, so now my software crashed. Let me restart this. Okay. So we are back. So now we should have you should be able to see the video again. Screen again, and okay. So what we do is we can plot just the x and the y things. And if we look at our data, we saw that the first data point is in the order of millions and the last data point was in the order of billions, which in this example, for example, makes it difficult for the built-in plot functionality to figure out what is a good range of y values. So we need to specify that please show all the data and then also join all the data points so that we don't have points and lines. Okay, Since we span many orders of magnitude, it's usually better to plot the data on a logarithmic scale. This is done here on the right-hand side, where we see that for the first 10,000 years, we just had an exponential population growth, because this is basically a linear increase of world population as seen here in this plot. There are some things to improve. So things that are bad here is we don't have any labels on the axis. So what is the x-axis? What is the y-axis? And the software, Mathematica in this case, doesn't know that the first number here is supposed to be a date. We can like modify the data to make it a date object. Then we have some additional plotting functionality, which looks like this, so not too different. But we can, for example, improve our plot and add frame label, for example. This. To make sure that people who see our figure actually understand what's being shown. So now we have here proper labels on the axis. So this is an example of two-dimensional data. So that's pretty simple, of course. You know this. What do we have here? Okay. If you have three-dimensional data, this can come in many different forms. For example, let me set up an artificial data set. So this is now a collection of X, Y, and C data points. Just let's take a look at the first few data. So we have an X position, a Y position, and some C position. And we can, for example, do a contour plot as is also commonly done, for example, for geographical data. If you have any map with height information, this is shown in contour plots. And this data looks like this. And you see that immediately, you see that a contour plot seems to be a bad choice. And the reason is if I like make this larger, this is how the contours look like. The reason is, if we look at the data, that I added some artificial noise to my data. And the noise produces these chaotic contour levels. If I remove this and redo the data, let me do it like this. Let me create an alternative data. And then show both data sets. this is good. And we immediately see the influence that our noise has on the contour plot. Which is of course a result of the noise level. So if I reduce the noise level, now that's here, let's say, then we can see a little bit better in the contour plot how the data looks like. So, but again, we have the contours following like numbers of the same numerical value, which breaks up the clean contour of the underlying data here in these somewhat chaotic data. Since this is three-dimensional data, we can also like try to create three-dimensional figures where we have the x and the y values shown as this height information. And here, if we look from certain angles, we see like the underlying structure of the data, but again, in the noisy data, this might not be helpful. Mist density plot. An alternative is not to plot contours, but plot the density. So that's basically the color that's behind the contours here, which for example looks like this. So now the C value is encoded as a color, and that's being explained here on the with the color bar on the right hand side. Okay. Another example is four-dimensional data. With higher dimensions, we have to come up with alternative strategies because it's even difficult to show three-dimensional data on a flat screen. So some software solved this problem by showing these interactive data that you can look from different angles. But with four-dimensional data, this is not possible anymore. And we can use the same strategy that we did here, for example, and encode some of the dimensions with, for example, colors. So this is here just for some four-dimensional data. So four numbers. These are regular coordinates, x, y, and z, and some random number between 1 and 10. And this is, of course, not helpful. We can, some software packages have maybe built-in plot functionality to look at multi-dimensional data. This is here like an three-dimensional density plot showing basically the three-dimensional distribution of the data. Many times you need to have your own basically visualization. And what I do here is I, for every x, y, and z coordinate, I draw a little box and color it with the fourth value as color information. And because they are stacked, I make them partially transparent. So that means when I plot this, I can look at the color information. We see that this is only partially helpful because we can still not look into the center, but it might give us an idea on how the data is actually distributed. This is just an example. Okay. The 5D data I leave out because this is in the exercises. Let's take a look at six-dimensional data. We can like extrapolate this strategy of encoding higher dimensions with different visual characteristics. So we can use color, we can use for example, sizes of objects. Here's, for example, a five-dimensional data set where I use three coordinates to encode the position in three-dimensional space. I use the fourth dimension to specify, to visualize this as size of these little spheres, and the fifth dimension as color. So this allows me to spot some regularities in my data, which is more difficult if we just look at the data itself. So looking at maybe these, what's on here? Zu viel. When I look at these tables, it's very difficult for me to understand regularities, which is pretty simple by just looking at this figure. And we have additional information. We can for example encode the additional dimension as direction, and draw this figure where the direction is shown as an arrow. Anyways, if you have three-dimensional vector plot, then this is also a six-dimensional visualization because you have a three-dimensional position and you have a three-dimensional vector information, which makes it six-dimensional.